reduce the pressure, reduce the pressure below milli atmospheric pressure, 10 to the power minus 3 atmospheric pressure. And then he able to generate the few voltage, high voltage up to few kilovolt, and by the induction coil. And after applying this coil, he get again a discharge over there. But still, he reducing the pressure over the 10 to the power minus 3 atmospheric pressure, ATM. Then there is a presence of a gas. It is sufficient presence or sufficient amount of a gas over present in the tube. Because of that, we get a glow, or a Giesler get a glow. And these tubes and this shape of a different types of a tube is called as a Giesler tube. And then later on, around 1870, British physicist William Crookes and another were able to evacuate it. Means they now the pumping, vacuum pumping technology is very much developed, that William Crookes and another scientist able to pump this pump out this glass tube up to a very low much pressure, up to 10 to the minus 3 10 to the minus 6 atmospheric pressure. This the physicist to understand more or less understand the cathode ray, about the cathode ray. Then and this is the first shape of a glass tube designed by the William Crookes, and this is called as a Crookes tube. And then he applied the glass electrode in this glass tube, which is fitted with a metal cross, and this cathode is over here and this anode over here, and he apply a high voltage wahan pe apply karne ke baad, then what he see the picture like this. And then there is a pinkish glow over there, and at the end of this another end of at other end of this cathode ke dusre end mein he see the greenish glow over there, and which casts the shadow of this metal cross. Ye metal cross casts the shadow over there. Then he pressure over there, and so there is a presence of a some amount of gas, because of that we see this pinkish glow over there. But at the other another end of the cathode, we see the greenish luminous greenish light over there. This is called as a fluorescence. This fluorescence is because of this some kind of a particle hits over there. He concluded that some kind of a ray hit over there. Because of that, we get an he get at actually Crookes get a greenish glow over there. That is called as a now it is called as a fluorescence over there. And then after rebooting of means actually what kind of that rays or that what particle, what kind of radiation coming out of this cathode, in order to study that he put some magnet over there, and he sees the this ray or shadow get deflected over there. Means shadow get deflected by presence of this magnet. And if he flipped over the magnet after the flipping which is and in the tube means whatever the end at the surface over there, means Crookes tube can pass from this glass over there. So it can it pass, means he asked the question, and he started a window. He built a window at the end of a Crookes tube by the thin aluminium foil. He deposit over there thin aluminium foil and see that whether this cathode ray could pass through this window or not. And then he observed that there is a fluorescence over there. in the after and place a fluorescent screen out of that Crookes tube, and he see the fluorescence over there. And again, in 1894, Nikola Tesla noticed the damage of the film. And Nikola Tesla, in 1894, remember this year, 1894, Nikola Tesla observed the damage of the film, radiographic film, and this seems to be associated. And he concluded it seems to be associated with the Crookes tube experiment, and began to investigate in the radiant energy of invisible kind. As this type of energy is invisible, its effect is visible actually. So he tried to investigate that, and after that, in 1895, in 8 November 1895, another scientist, Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen, are working on that same experiment. He observed that there is a glow on the screen, which is painted with a barium platicocyanide, and about 1 meter away, which is glowing whenever the Crookes tube is applied with a voltage and it is started, then the glow is maximized. In that case, the glow observed by the Röntgen is a maximized. So it concluded that there is a sun-turn kind of a ray over there, and he very much excited over that, and he spent around 6 weeks in that lab to investigate what kind of a ray is that. And after getting a partial idea about that ray, he then in 22nd December 1895, he take his wife to his laboratory and take the picture of her hand. It is the picture of her hand where this signifies the ring in her hand, left hand. And then because of that rays is very much unknown, the exact nature of that rays is unknown. So that's why he called it as an X-ray. At that time, the nature was that radiation unknown. He does not mean, even he spent 6 weeks in the laboratory study that ray, but he could able to produce that ray and pointed in a certain direction, but he does not understand the nature of that X-ray. At that time, ether theory was proposed. It was established for a propagation of light rays or a propagation of waves in the medium. So mentioned that this ray is a etherical, means there is a certain shock wave present in the ether that travel in the form of the X-ray, and that affect the photographic plate, and that could be passed through this our flesh, human body, but it is obstructed by this bone. And with this discovery, in the honor of this discovery, in the honor, many people refer this radiation, X radiation, as a Röntgen radiation at that time. And then After his discovery, he wrote the letter or new kind of ray, which is a preliminary report, and submitted to the Physical Medical Society Journal in December 28, 1895. And after reading this report, people means other scientist community gone mad, and he tried to make that Crookes tube again. And they are taking a picture of their hand and another object or a living animal or their pets. Then after that, after this discovery, the medical researcher are very much enthusiastic about that. And with this discovery alone, in same year, there is a 49 essay, 23 magazine article, and over 1,000 research articles were published in that year. And so you can understand from this figure that how much craze were generated by this discovery in this at that time. On 11th January 1896, the first use of X-ray under the clinical condition was done by the John Hall Edwards in England, in which he radiographed the needle stuck in the his associate, he take a radiograph or X-ray photograph of this associate in which his needle is stuck in his hand, and this X-ray photographic technique, or at that time it is called as a Röntgen photographic technique, and they become a routine practice in the battlefield, where the they use the medical personnel use the that X-ray photographic technique for detecting bullets in the body, and they treated the soldiers with that. And after March 1896, the friend, this is not a, this need not to be included, but this in this lecture, because it is out of syllabus, that is in next year, 1896, the French physicist Henri Becquerel opened the drawer and discovered the radioactivity. In same way, in similar manner, just like as in a Röntgen, he discovered the X-ray, Becquerel also discovered the radioactivity. The photograph of Becquerel, and in latter year, electron in 1897. This discovery need not to be included in this lecture, but this discovery are very much important in order to develop the modern physics. These three discovery in consecutive year changes the whole view of the scientist to look at the matter or physical theories. That changes the theories, and after that the theory is called as a modern physics or modern science. This is a picture of a J.J. Thomson. And after that, initially it was believed that X-ray passed through the flesh, means whenever they take an X-ray of their body part, hand, body part, chest or a head, then they assume that the X-ray passed through that flesh is very harmlessly. It doesn't cause any harm. But after a certain, after routine practice, the certain scientists or certain practitioner report the cases of a burn, means side effect. They report the side effect of the exposure of this X-ray. As we know that X-ray exposure is, nowadays we know that X-ray exposure is very hazardous or very dangerous. But at that time, it took a larger time, because this technique is very much popular at that time, that the scientist or a community uses is a very much larger way. And outcomes of a hazardous reports or a hazardous reported at that time very much less. And in 1904, Thomas Edison's Clarence Daly, who worked X-ray. So he worked with the X-ray. He's for in order to understand the properties of X-ray. And after the extensive studies of X-ray, he caused a death. Means Daly was died because of this high exposure of X-ray. And because of that high exposure of X-ray, he caused a skin cancer, and that because of he get died because of that. And after that, scientific community become aware that some kind of a hazardous or some kind of a damage that this X-ray could made or could produce in a human body or human flesh. Okay, and then this is the short history of this X-ray discovery, and we see the development. At initially, the X-ray were produces the sources of X-ray was a Crookes tube, which is designed by this, which is later on little modified by this. This is Röntgen, and later word for commercial purposes, this Crookes tube was developed or a newly designed by this William Coolidge, in which he put on a this cathode anode in this way evacuated in a evacuated glass tube, which is still in our syllabus and which is still, again, it is in an application. This is also used for day-to-day application, means whenever there is a commercial, you go to the hospital for a diagnostic center for a X-ray. Then in that X-ray machine, this tube is over present over there. So this is a basic construction of this X-ray tube is like that, that it consists of a cathode which emits an electron by thermionic emission, again, is electron get accelerated with a high potential towards this anode. And after it gets struck, the X-rays were pointed in a 45 degrees to the anode alignment. What is the inclined anode surface, it emits a 45 degree to that. And nearly 1% of energy is converted into the X-ray. So that's why it is, and rest of the energy is converted into the heat. So that's why it is in need to the continuous cooling. And various modification later on, just like as in this rotating anode present over there. So these are the various modification that could be done by the scientist for their scientific study. But this type of a tube is still isn't in use for commercial purpose. Now, then next source of X-ray discovered in scientist community observed that the electron loses its energy by emitting X-ray tangentially to that orbit. Whenever we know that Clark Maxwell put the theory that electron accelerate or decelerate produces a radiation. But in 1947, what mentioned by this, in which direction the X-ray could be emitted could not be mentioned by this Planck. But in 1947, there is an acceleration, electron gives a X-rays over there. X-rays. And by using this concept, the scientists did a synchrotron over there. So this is a picture of a synchrotron or electron where very high energy and potential wherever the energy of increase, energy of electron increase or energy of charged particle increase by the help of a magnet, by the help of an electric field, and it is bent in a circular shape or a bended in a different trajectory in the different trajectory by a magnet. So this type of a bend, whatever you see in the ring, it is a magnetic.
Hello.
Am I audible, sir? Hello. So this is the source of X-ray. This is a new generation source of X-ray. It is used in a high-end and a high-end commercial purposes. Just like as in this treatment, X-ray treatment, using treatment of a cancer using a X-ray. This is this technique. This is the latest technique using a X-ray for a cancer treatment. This is called as an intensity modulated X-radiation IMXT or X-ray therapy, in which this X-ray is located in the body and that calculation is done in order to give the proper dose to this cancerous cell or cancer lesion or tumor to kill that tumor cell over there. So this is the picture of a treatment planning and treatment. Okay, then we'll see the Nobel Prizes. Actually, there is a various field in a physics, but the X-ray is one of the only field which get a largest Nobel Prizes, which collected. We see that a chemistry in the chemistry in the chemistry subject get a 20 Nobel Prizes, physics get a 17, and a physiology or a medicine branch it get a Nobel Prizes over there. Even though it is a physics topic, then also chemistry subject get a larger number of prizes. And from a starting from a Röntgen, with the discovery of the X-ray, he get a first ever Nobel Prize in a physics in 1901. And later word, many scientists get a Nobel Prizes over there. And it continues till the last Nobel Prize in X-ray field, it's getting a 2013. Still, this is a X-ray is a field of study or field of research have a potential till even after 100 years after, 100 years after. Okay. So Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen is awarded with a Nobel Prize in 1901 for a discovery of X-ray. Then later word, many scientists studies the X-ray for in order to understand the nature of X-ray. First, it was understand that X-ray is only a wave nature, or some community of scientists argue that there are the X-ray is of a particle nature. And later word, means later word in a, wait a minute. Compton effect, Arthur Holly Compton in 1927, he was awarded for a Nobel Prize for a discovery of a Compton effect. And after that, it is established that X-ray is a dual, is of a dual nature. It is both, it has a both nature, wave nature also and particle nature also. Okay. So these are the list of Nobel Prizes awarded in the field of X-ray. It goes up to till 2013, which was in 2000 chemistry for a development of a multi-scale model for a complex chemical system. This studies or this research was done with the help of a X-ray. So that's why it is included in the field of a X-ray. And now we will see the characteristic. What we know about the X-ray in today's world. Okay. In order to understand the X-ray, we have to know the about the electromagnetic spectrum. So this is the picture shows the electromagnetic spectrum from a and it has a various regions such as a radio region at lower wavelength, higher lower frequency region or lower energy region, and another end it has a gamma rays which have a low wavelength, high frequency or high energy region. And within this ultraviolet and gamma rays, there is one region that is called as an X-ray, which is a matter of interest right now. Okay, it has a wavelength of a few angstrom to hundreds of few picometers over there. And it is comparable to the atomic scale. Okay, so this is the electromagnetic spectrum. We'll see what exactly mean by this electromagnetic spectrum and how this electromagnetic spectrum or how this radiation of different zones interact with matter or interact with another material particle, and how we see that how we perceive that interaction. Let's see, this is an example of the surface different radiation of a different zone. This is taken by this microwave. This is a 3.3 mm wavelength microwave. clear picture. We see the clear picture. This is a superficial picture when we see the skin part only. When we see the same picture with the UV ultraviolet light, we see the picture like this. And this shows the dark spot shows the surfaces or effects that just lies just below the skin. Means whatever the blood flow or blood flow increases in the skin over there, that could be observed by using ultraviolet. And when we reduce again wavelength over there and we move to the X-rays and we see the picture like this. We see the picture of a human skeleton or a bones over there. And whatever the bone structure that supports the flesh over the body, we can see by using a X-ray. So these are the various region, and you can understand what exactly the electromagnetic spectrum stands, where the X-ray stands in the electromagnetic spectrum and what is it see for its use. And then we see the we categorize this X-ray in a soft X-ray, which is near to the ultraviolet light. That is a soft X-ray, which is having a less energy. It has a larger energy, greater energy than comparatively ultraviolet light, but is it a smaller energy or a less energy than a gamma rays. That X-rays, which is having a lower wavelength, higher wavelength or lower frequency, it's called as a soft X-ray. It has a low energy. And then again, another type of X-ray, which is a hard X-ray near to the gamma rays, which have a higher energy. We use that X-ray in a X-ray crystallography and then radiology over there and then security purposes over there. We can see that in movie also that airport security at airport or quality control in industries that could be done by using this hard X-ray. Initially, at the time of a discovery, the glass tube is not susceptible, means glass tube, the vacuum inside that glass tube and the voltage could be generated by this induction coil or a transformer is not that much high. So initially, the whatever the scientist produces, that is in a soft X-ray. So that's why the picture, what we see at the initially in this presentation, that is because of a soft X-ray. So that's why its resolution is not that much high. And after a development in the science and scientist community are able to produce voltages up to a larger value, means up to mega voltage value, that enables them to produce a hard X-ray. Higher the value of a voltage in the voltage applied to the X-ray tube, the harder the X-ray will be. Higher energy X-ray could be produced over there. So that could be used in a various application. So that's why initially that X-ray used in the medical field rather than an industrial field. And after the increase in the voltage, means after the mega voltage, when the scientists are able to produce and apply to the tube, then hard X-ray produces, then that hard X-ray is used in industrial purposes. Now we see that X-ray, what is the exactly X-ray means to us now? X-ray is a form of electromagnetic radiation. At present, we understand this because for 100 years of our study, we established this concept that we haven't fully understood the nature of the X-ray. It is the electromagnetic radiation. It also behaves like as in a particle also for a whenever we are studying the scattering experiment and whenever we are studying the crystallography or a wave, we are looking at a wave property and it is behave like as in a wave. So X-rays has a wavelength around 0.1 to 10 angstrom and it has frequency like this and energy is within the range of a kilo some finite इलेक्ट्रॉन वोल्ट, हम सम हंड्रेड ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉन वोल्ट टू किलो इलेक्ट्रॉन वोल्ट, हंड्रेड्स ऑफ अ किलो किलो इलेक्ट्रॉन वोल्ट, एंड दे आर कैपेबल ऑफ अ ट्रेवलिंग इन वैक्यूम. सो इट इज अ इलेक्ट्रोमैग्नेटिक रेडिएशन, सो इट इज कैपेबल ऑफ ट्रेवलिंग इन वैक्यूम. So they travel in straight line and do not carry electrical charge. So that's why it is a neutral, and that's why it is not affected by this magnetic or electric field. And they shows the very property, every property, whatever the property shown by the, they show the same property, all of the properties for them. Then this is the production of a X-ray by using a Coolidge tube. We have discussed earlier in this Coolidge tube. So in that Coolidge tube, whatever the voltage applied, whatever the energy supplied that Coolidge tube, the X-ray produces, means there is a conservation of energy, conversion of energy from electrical energy to the X-ray energy. And whatever the energy supplied this Coolidge tube, out of that only 1% of energy is converted into the X-ray, and rest of the energy is converted to the heat. So that's why the anode material, in the that Coolidge tube is continuously cooled down. So that high amount of energy that needed to be dissipated. So that's why it is needed to be cooled down. So that's why the water or oil circulated into that tube over there to cool down that anode. And we get if we record this energy, X-ray energy emitted out from that tube with respect to the wavelength, intensity versus wavelength, we get this type of radiation. We get continuous radiation, and we get spikes over there. That spike is called as a characteristic X-ray spectrum. I'm not going into the detail of origin of this X-ray spectrum, continuous or characteristic. I'm here to only present what exactly the X-ray produces and whatever the mechanism over there. Okay, see, this is a mechanism wherever the target, where the X-ray electron target over this anode, and what does each electron do see over that target? It sees the every element, every atom of that element separately, and it interacts differently with a different manner. There is the four type of way. There is a characteristic X-ray spectra, a characteristic X-ray, or a continuous X-ray. Okay. So in the current, so this is all about the X-ray up to this time. We have whatever understanding we have. Okay. Now, X-ray in current modern world, it is applied in a many field, and some of it over here. Most of the field is a medical field. Frequent application of this X-ray is a medical field, such as a computer X-ray radiograph over there, just like a dental radiography over there, cardiovascular vascular radiology over there, 2D radiography over there, computer tomography that could produce a 3D or 2D or 3D picture of a patient, and it could locate the cancer lesion or cancer tumor cell. For security purposes, for weapon detecting, could be in that field, X-ray could be used. And then again, next field sector is a food safety, means food and drug. It is used in a quality analysis or a preservation also. X-ray could be used in a food preservation purposes, for food preservation purposes. And based on this, we have various requirement for a development. For there means there are various requirement of a human resources, and what kind of a human resources over there that are the career scope, means whenever you pursue the X-ray radiology course, there is a level or different levels of a radiology courses over there, just like as a certificate course of 1 year, diploma course of a 2 year, undergraduate course of a 3 year and 3 or 4 year, and postgraduate course in a of a 2 year, or postgraduate diploma over there of 1 year So there are different types of courses of radiology over there. And what are the whatever the options or career scope for the radio X-ray radiology over there. So after possessing this radiology course, one could become a radiologist, could become a CT scan technologist, could become a radiology technologist, then MRI technician, radiology assistant. Depending upon the level of a radiology course that what we do, we could have a different roles in the radiology field of the radiology. Radiology assistant, radiology nurse, and radiology technician. And apart from this medical field, we have another sectors in which we have a career scope. As you know that various radiological facility emerged out in this COVID-19 period, pandemic period, because of inability, means whenever there is an RT-PCR test cannot detect the COVID-19 virus. So doctor refers you to the, means doctor prescribed the CT scan report to go for the CT scan report. And from CT scan report, they predict that whether the patient is affected by this COVID-19 virus or not. Means they predict over there. So CT scan or X-ray techniques is emerged out and it's a requirement in the India. In India is very much larger over there. So there is a very much vacant space, vacant. And apart from that medical field, you could become a security officer at airport or any other the material processor, such like as an gear or any instrument produces in the industries, you could check the qualities of that, whether there is a crack or not. Even fine crack could destroy the whole structure over there. So that quality control is, or quality monitoring is very much essential in the industries. Also over there, the quality control or quality monitoring is very much essential. So the industry appoints human resource over there. Then food and drug safety again, and a research scientist. If you continue your studies, and then you could become a research scientist. You could pursue the research over there. So many research institute could hire the research scientists which have an expertise in a X-ray analysis or a X-ray material, such like as a materialologist or a material scientist over there. So these are the all about the X-ray. I just briefly covered this from the history, from the origin or a discovery to the current scenario of the X-ray. Now, any question, free to ask. And thank you for your kind attention. Hello, sir. Presentation is over, sir.
Okay. Hello.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful lecture. I'm sure our students would be benefited from this. So we have come to end of the program, and at this end, I would like to formally record our thanks to our principal, Dr. M.B. Bagre, sir, under whose guidance we have organized this webinar. And I would also like to thank head of the department, sir, for extending his support. And most importantly, thank is due to Dr. K.V. Dabre, sir, for giving his valuable time and giving this wonderful lecture. So with this, I can say that this program has come to an end. Thank you so much.